So as we take a look at a mix of parables of Jesus between now and the beginning of Lent, which is 2 Sundays away from now, today we come to the story of the Good Samaritan, a story which follows, as we heard Pat read, which follows the great commandment to love God and to love neighbor, which is that two-part commandment that is at the heart of our Christian faith. So the story of the Good Samaritan is an important story coming after that. It's one that illustrates this key commandment. It's a story about crossing the distance that separates people. And like all the parables, it's a story about what God's heart looks like. In church school, the kids will be looking at the story too, though because of the snow and some scheduling things, they'll be looking at it a little bit later next month rather than today. And when they do, the story will be laid out in front of them and put into action. They will see the scene laid out with felt or with wooden figures to represent the different characters involved. They will see the length of road stretching between Jericho and Jerusalem, a wide road with rocks on either side. They will see the man who is beat up by robbers on one side of the road, abandoned there, and they'll see other figures, starting with the priest, walk by on the other side of the road, trying to be as far away from that injured man as possible. Seeing the physical space of the scene that way means that certain parts stand out in a different way when the story plays out in my head than it might when I just hear it read the way we heard it this morning. Seeing that distance, that stretch of road between Jericho and Jerusalem, highlights the length of the journey that all of these people are traveling. It highlights the length, the distance. And seeing the width between one side of the road where the man is lying and the other side of the road highlights the distance in body and in spirit between the man who was robbed and left there and the others. This story is about crossing that distance that separates people. And those distances are critical in the parable. There's spatial distance, but there's also emotional distance between the different people involved. And both the spatial distance and the emotional distance are what must be traversed to make the point that Jesus is trying to make about love of God and love of neighbor. Now, when Jesus tells this parable of the Good Samaritan, the Samaritan who is traveling between Jerusalem and Jericho in the parable, Jesus himself, when he's telling this story, is traveling between Jericho and Jerusalem in the other direction. So our passage is a journey within a journey. It's a story within a journey, within a story. And so the meaning of the parable, which is the little inner story, also it takes place in an outer story about what's happening to Jesus at that time, in that moment. Jesus is on the road to Jerusalem, where he knows that he will be arrested and betrayed in just a few chapters later. He's on the road to Jerusalem where he knows that he will die. And so he tells the story in that personal context. He's on a journey. And he knows that his journey will leave him kind of like that man in the parable, on the side of the road with powerful people passing right by. So Jesus tells this parable as a story within a story, as a journey within his journey. That is about, and the story is about crossing that distance that separates people. In his time, there were particular distances between Jews and Samaritans, the two people involved in the story. Jews and Samaritans were not just strangers in the story, so it's not simply a message about being helpful to strangers. Rather, Jews and Samaritans were people who lived in nearby geographic areas, right next door to each other, and yet couldn't stand the other group's way of life or practice of religion. The teacher, Amy Jill Levin, explains, is there any group whose members might rather die than help us? That is the kind of contempt, the kind of enmity that existed between Jews in Jesus' time. And so Levin admits that for her, as a modern Jew, a member of Hamas might be her equivalent of the Samaritan in this story, the one who she wouldn't expect to help her, and the one who maybe whose help she would not even want. So there are distances in this story that are being crossed. And all around us, there are still such distances. At a large scale, there are distances between groups of people, between Christians and Muslims, between Methodists and other types of Christians, between Democrats and Republicans, people born in this country and people who have immigrated here, people of one race, people of another race. So many large-scale distances. On a smaller scale, we know personal distances between one side of the family and another, between classmates or coworkers, between father and son or mother-in-law and daughter-in-law, between husband and wife. In our lives, too, there are such distances. When I really think about it, when I take this parable seriously and let it sit inside of me, it makes me a little uncomfortable. It touches my fear of getting close to people I don't know, people who might hurt me, people who might need something that is more than I can give. It touches my fear of getting closer to people who I do know, knowing that they've hurt me in the past. It touches my fear of ending up powerless on the side of the road myself. It touches my fear of being uncomfortable, and often getting close to other people is uncomfortable, at least at first. Perhaps you share some of these fears. Perhaps you have your own mix of them. The Samaritan in our story probably has his fears, too. In fact, this isn't the first time that Samaritans show up in Luke's gospel. Just a little bit earlier in Jesus' journey to Jerusalem, so just a few passages before what we read this morning, Jesus had stopped in a Samaritan town, and they refused to welcome him there. Remember what we said earlier about the difficult relationships between Jews and Samaritans. Maybe the Samaritans in that town were afraid that Jesus had ulterior motives. Maybe they were used to people who spoke like Jesus and looked like Jesus being untrustworthy. Maybe they just didn't want to extend hospitality. Whatever the reason, the Samaritans in that village did not welcome him. And yet when Jesus tells this parable, he makes the hero a Samaritan. Anyway, however Samaritans had mistreated him just a short time ago, the Samaritan here is the one who presents as the example to follow. The Samaritan here is the example of the one who follows the law of God. And what that Samaritan does is he crosses the distance of the road that separates him from another human being like himself. He doesn't pass by on the other side, like the priest and like the Levite before him. Instead, he draws near. That's what it means to be a neighbor, Jesus says. The English word neighbor comes from an old English word, centuries back as the language was developing, nigh, which means near, and geber, which means dweller, near dweller. To be a neighbor is to dwell near. To draw near is to become a neighbor, and that is what the Samaritan does in our story this morning. The fact that this hero in the parable is a Samaritan is radical. Jesus is the one telling this story, and it shows his awareness of just how complex people can be. His awareness that he can't make generalizations about a group, because there's good even among the one that seems bad. There is good and there is bad in each of us, in you, in me. There are fears in us. There are distorted views in us. And yet there is great capacity in us to love. There is great capacity in us to cross the distance that separates us from other people. There's capacity in us to draw near. Two Sundays ago, during our interfaith Martin Luther King Day service that was held here, we had the privilege of hearing a woman speak named Sandy, who lives in Oakland, just down the street. And Sandy is a refugee from Syria. She escaped the war there, where her family lived down the street from buildings that were bombed, where she was shot at times in the street, where her family still lives uncertain if they'll be able to find a way out like she has. So Sandy has traveled a great distance from Syria to New Jersey. She's traveled through dangerous places along the way. And she said that what has sustained her has been the way that people she has encountered have not walked to the other side of the street, but have stepped up and cared for her. She's part of a church, Pons Reformed Church in Oakland, and they stepped up over to her side of the road. They came near, and she has developed this sense of neighbors all around her because of it. It's a kind of small-scale instance of crossing the distance and of putting love in action that is where the hope of larger-scale action and change begins. Those seemingly small actions of crossing the distance matter. They aren't always noticed, but when we see them, they offer hope. And one example of how that offers hope, this year the Nobel Peace Prize Nomination Committee is working on nominating not an individual, not some name that we all know, but a small group of people who live on some Greek islands in the Aegean Sea. The sea, which is the same sea that many refugees, thousands of refugees, have left Syria to cross. And these islanders, many of them who are fishermen, or teachers, or grandmothers, these islanders have welcomed boat after boat of refugee, rescuing many of the people on those boats from sickness and from death. The Nobel Peace Prize Nominating Committee comments on the empathy and the self-sacrifice of this group of people, these communities of people in Greece, who themselves are living in a nation that is experiencing deep economic crisis. So whatever big headlines we see about the politics of this crisis or of any other crisis, hearing about stories like these islanders give me hope in the power of human kindness in the midst of it, in the power of drawing near to the people around us, people who are already around us and people who end up in newly around us, who end up on our doorstep. And so while there are so many issues, big and small, that call for response in our world, I'm focusing just on these examples of the refugee crisis, both globally and locally, because it's one that offers so many poignant examples of what it means to cross that distance that can separate us. It's a situation that offers poignant examples that reflect what the parable of the Good Samaritan is about. These examples get at the courage that the story asks of us. It asks for our courage because drawing near rather than passing by on the other side requires acknowledging and facing fears. Fears that might even be biologically or neurochemically hardwired into us. It takes courage to face those fears. It takes courage to cross those distances between us, even when they're small distances. And it is good news to hear this story this morning, because as we see in those examples, change starts there, with crossing those small distances. Because it's crossing those small distances that large distances are also crossed. The story is good news, because it shows us what the heart of God looks like. And it shows us our potential to embody that heart of God in the world around us. To embody the heart of God in a world that so deeply needs to see and know and believe God's heart. To end, the Dalai Lama offers a really beautiful way of explaining the message of the Good Samaritan. He explains it this way. He says, what you wish to experience, provide for another. Look to see now what it is you wish to experience in your own life or in the world. If you wish to experience peace, provide peace for another. If you wish to know that you are safe, cause another person to know that they are safe. If you wish to heal your own sadness or anger, seek to heal the sadness or the anger of another. Those others are waiting for you now. They are looking to you for love. The parable of the Good Samaritan is a challenge to us to find that courage to lessen the distance that exists between us and other people. It's a challenge to provide for another person, whether they live in our world or our country or our town, or whether they are somebody who lives in our very house with us, to provide for that other person what we wish to know for ourselves. The parable is a challenge to draw near, because loving God and loving neighbor starts there, with drawing near. So may we draw near to the God who draws near to us. May we draw near to our neighbor. And may we live out that love that we seek.
Please join me with a prayer of confession. God,